everyone, and welcome to Rainier View. My name is Jess. Thank you so much for joining us today. For those of you that are new with us, we have several resources for you at rvcc.online. These include a great lesson for your kids, links to our online service for students, and more. You can also submit a connection card to let us know a little bit about you and your family, as well as prayer requests so that members of our team can be praying for your needs. We're going to start off the service with a couple of worship songs followed by a message, and then I'll come back and close us out and lead us in a time of communion. Thanks again for being here with us, and enjoy the service.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! And together we sing. Everyone sing. Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth and the earth is filled with His glory. Stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! Together we sing. Everyone saying, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory, and the earth is filled with His glory, and it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown, and it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown, and together we sing. Everyone sing, holy is the Lord God. Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth and the earth is filled with His glory.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as You find me, and all my fears and failures. Oh Lord, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shining light and let the whole world see. The glory of the risen King Jesus, shining light in the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Thanks, Trevor and Thomas, for leading us in worship. Hey, we want to make sure that you are staying connected during this time, and here are some ways that you can do that. You can sign up to receive our church emails, you can follow us on Facebook, and you can follow us on Instagram. We also want to keep you up to date with the latest information as it pertains to reopening our physical campuses in Graham and Parkland. The best way to do that is for you to sign up for our regular church emails on our website now. God has been doing some amazing things, and lives are continuing to be transformed in these uncertain times. There have been a number of baptisms that have taken place recently, and we wanted to share some of those with you. So take a look. We are a church that loves to be generous and invest in helping people grow spiritually and experience God's hope and peace in their lives. You can give by simply texting RVCC to 77977 to use our safe and secure online system. You can also give from our website or mail in a check. If you're new with us, please don't feel obligated to give in any way. We're just so glad that you're here today. All right, let's join Pastor Mike as we continue in our series, Essential.
Hey there, welcome. We are continuing on our series called Essential. We're going through the book of 1 Thessalonians. But before I get into the scripture today, I just want to brag about my wife a little bit. And she is amazing for so many different reasons. But during the season of quarantine, I appreciate her so much more and her desire to be able to help our family make memories and find different fun things to do in summertime so that we're not just trapped in the house all the time. And something that she did just this past month that I was just blown away is she organized the first ever Father's Day quarantine Olympics. Okay. And this was amazing. This was kind of like her surprise for me for Father's Day. And so over the course of Father's Day weekend, we played 10 different games as a family competing against each other. Except it wasn't just our family. She also invited a bunch of different families from Washington. A lot of the families that we know and love from back in Arizona were invited to be part of it, to take place in different events of highly skilled competition, like Dizzy George, which is taking a quarter and seeing how long you can get it to spin. It could go on forever because I'm great at that game, but that's not what I came in any good place in. Another game that we played was the Bottle Flip Challenge, something that some of you recognize this game and it'll drive you insane that I'm gonna bring it back, but it's a matter of how many times you can get the bottle to land in the course of 1 minute. And I am really terrible at it, but because my ego says so, I'm gonna keep doing this until I get it to work. So we're just gonna keep going, and the sermon is gonna be like 45 minutes today because I can't get this to work. Okay, there we go. So that's the bottle flip challenge. Props to Luke Mulder, who got it to land 30 times in 1 minute. Unbelievable. So we played those games, and then the one event that I did particularly well in, it was my highest placement any of them, called the sock slide, and I can't really explain it. You just need to see it for yourself. So as you can see, I'm quite good at the sock slide, going a distance of 14 feet and 11 inches, which was good enough to get one of these prestigious prizes, an incredible, unbelievable ribbon. Now you may be saying, Mike, that's a second place ribbon right there. Yes, yes it is. I came in second place to my son Logan. Well, he's 6'4", and he slid about 4 inches further than I did, so I'm just gonna blame the height difference, and that's why I didn't get first place. But I was thankful to come in that high, competing against all sorts of incredible athletes all over Washington and Arizona. And so I've got the different ribbons from this fun weekend kind of hanging in my office. And I was looking at them last week for whatever reason, and I noticed something about the design of the ribbon. Okay, now we're gonna do something a little bit different here. If you are gathered at home or in somebody else's house, we're gonna throw an image up on the screen of this ribbon, a close-up, and I want you to try to figure out, see who in the room can figure out kind of what the insignia, what that little symbol is that's around the second place number right there. So we're gonna give you about 15 seconds on screen to check that out, and then I'll be back to tell you what it is. Okay, time's up. Hopefully somebody in your group or maybe several people got it right, because the answer is a laurel wreath. Okay, so if anybody in your room said laurel wreath, winner, winner, chicken dinner, make somebody else in the room pay for your chicken dinner, because I'm not going to. Now, in ancient Greece, a laurel wreath, that's what the victorious athletes were presented at the end of the race or whatever to wear on their heads. And it's something that we got to see again, which was very cool, in the Olympics that were held in Greece in the year 2004. We've got a shot here of an athlete getting to wear one of those. The laurel wreath goes back to ancient Greek times. And Greece is where the city of Thessalonica was located. And so if you have your Bible or the Bible app on a device, I want you to go ahead and find your way and navigate to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And as you're finding your way there, I want to remind you of the relationship that Paul has with the believers in the city of Thessalonica. Paul and his companions in Acts 17, they come into the city and they start preaching about Jesus. Paul is teaching about Jesus in the Jewish synagogue on three separate weeks here. And in Acts chapter 17, verse 4, we read the following. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. Okay, so Paul's there, and after just a few weeks of preaching, there are a bunch of influential people that are beginning to place their faith in Jesus. And upon learning this, the Jewish leaders in the city get so jealous that they form this angry mob to chase Paul out of town. And so Paul has to leave, and despite numerous efforts to return to the city, Paul is unable to do so. And so later on, he sends this church a letter to encourage them, to build them up in their faith, because he can't physically be there to do so. And towards the end of chapter 2, we read the following. This is beginning in verse 17. But, brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. I don't know about you, but as I'm reading this, I can feel Paul's anguish in not being able to be with the believers in this city. You know, he's trying everything that he can do to get back there to these people, but he can't find a way. And so in these verses, he writes of a time when he will get to see them, when he will be able to be reunited with him in the future life, you know, when they get to be reunited, not only with others, but with Jesus. And this is something that all believers, all followers of Jesus can look forward to, a day when we get to be in the presence of Jesus in heaven. And so Paul speaks of this time, and he talks about kind of this joy and this hope that he will experience. And he talks about it. He says this phrase that maybe doesn't make a whole lot of sense. He says, what is our hope, our joy, or our crown that we will glory in? Well, this crown isn't the kind of crown that a king would wear, okay? Maybe some of you recognize that image right there. But the Greek word that Paul uses for crown here is the word Stephanos, okay? And Stephanos means a crown of victory, like a laurel wreath, okay? And so Paul is writing that someday when I get to be with you again, when we are reunited with Christ in heaven, it'll be like that incredible feeling of victory that a champion has, that I get to see you again in heaven someday. And he's just so looking forward to that moment when he is reunited with them in heaven with Jesus. And so it's with this beautiful imagery that Paul is painting of this future victory in Jesus that Paul concludes his letter to the Thessalonians. Let's pray. No, let's not pray, because that's not the end of the letter. That's not how Paul finishes it. In fact, we're not even halfway through this letter. And some of you are like reading along going like, end of the letter? What is he talking about? Pastor Mike has lost it. Yeah, probably. But he's going to continue on, because actually between chapters 2 and 3 is a critical juncture in this letter. Okay, that as he moves forward, it's all about strengthening this church now. Because Paul is not just satisfied with this idea that I'll get to see you again someday. I'll get to be with you in heaven someday. That's not going to be good enough for Paul. In fact, you might say that Paul is not going to rest on his laurels. Now, the pun police are coming for me, so I need to speed up here. As we enter into chapter 3, Paul's focus in this letter, it shifts to helping his readers establish their faith. Why? Because it is essential to strengthen the faith of others. I'm going to say that again. It is essential to strengthen the faith of others. Now, you may be asking the question, well, wait a second, why is that essential? You know, in the past couple weeks, Jeff and I have talked about different things that are essential for the faith of a believer. I talked in the second week, this idea that we are experiencing change. You know, change is essential for the believer, that inside I'm being changed to become more like Jesus. Last week, Jeff talked about how community is essential for the believers. And so maybe you're wondering, like, well, wait a second, Why is strengthening other people's faith essential for me? You know, I know that I'm responsible for my own personal growth in both knowledge of God's word and growing in my intimacy with God, you know, spending time in the word, spending time in prayer so that I am growing with him. But our personal pursuit of God cannot come at the expense of failing to help others do the same. In fact, the strength of your relationship with Jesus is intertwined with how you help others pursue God. And as we read on in chapter 3 now, we're going to see how essential Paul believed that it was to strengthen the faith of others. And so we're going to jump into chapter 3. I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 10. And Paul writes, "So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in the faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you and that our labors might have been in vain. But Timothy has just now come to us from you and has brought us good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us, just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith." Okay, so for those of you keeping score at home, the phrase "your faith" comes up 5 different times in this passage. You might even want to go back in your Bible. You might want to underline the 5 different times that Paul says "your faith," or if you've got the Bible app on your device, maybe you want to highlight those verses. And I ask you to do that because what we see from Paul here is that Paul is not only concerned about the eternal salvation of the Thessalonians. Now, clearly, he cares a lot about that. You know, his missionary journeys was to spread the gospel. He wanted people to know about Jesus, to make Jesus Lord. But that wasn't Paul's only concern on these missionary journeys. With the Thessalonians, we see that he is equally concerned for their present situation. He cares about their eternal salvation, but he also concerns himself with how they're doing right now. And he's forced to leave this city, and he's chased out of the city due to persecution. And because there are no phones, there's no email, there's no social media, Paul can't keep up with him. He has no idea how these dear brothers and sisters are doing back in this city that is just full of chaos and craziness and mob mentality because of him. It's killing him that he hasn't been able to go there. He's left the believers behind in this city that's honestly hostile to the message of Jesus. And so it's no wonder that Paul repeats variations of this phrase, "when I couldn't stand it anymore." Like he's losing it because he wants to know desperately how they're doing. But Paul wasn't going to let a matter of distance stop him from doing whatever he could to strengthen their faith. And so what does he do? Well, I want us to go back to verse 2. He writes, "We sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service, in spreading the gospel of Christ to strengthen and encourage you in the faith." So what Paul does, even though he can't be there, he sends Timothy in his place to be with them during these difficult times. Now, you may be wondering, well, why did Timothy get to go back when Paul couldn't go back? That doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And the only thing that I could surmise is that it comes down to the fact that Timothy just didn't have the face and name recognition that Paul did. You know, in Acts 17:5, when you know this mob that's been stirred up by the Jews, like we read this in Acts 17:5, "They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd." The mob is looking for Paul and Silas. They're not looking for Timothy. Okay, Timothy had only recently joined Paul on this missionary journey. You know, Acts 17 is where we read about this episode in Thessalonica. It's in Acts 16. that they discover Timothy and bring him along. So Timothy hasn't been with him very long. Again, Paul is the face. Paul is the voice that's in front of the synagogue. He is the one that's preaching. And so Timothy is able to go back into the city and kind of fly under the radar because he's not the face of Christianity at this point. And I love this about Paul. I appreciate his humility in being able to send Timothy instead of insisting, I've got to be the one that goes back. I'm the one that led him to Christ. Like, I've got to go back there. There's no ego in this where he's like, I have to find a way, like, disguise me, you know, hide me underneath a bunch of hay and get me back into the city somehow. Like, he's done what he can, and so he's going to send Timothy in his place. He doesn't have to be the only one to do this. And sometimes we need to learn that. It can't be, you know, if you're going to do something right, just do it yourself. So sometimes you have to entrust other people to do that, you know. And clearly Paul trusts Timothy. I mean, we see how he refers to him. He says that he is a co-worker, you know, in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ. Now for Paul, it's incredibly important that he had Timothy with him as he's out going from place to place spreading the gospel. But it was, again, it was just as important to Paul that the Thessalonians were growing in their faith. And so he sends Timothy at cost to himself. This is a sacrifice that Paul is making by sending Timothy. But he sends Timothy because he wants to make sure that the Thessalonians keep taking steps of faith. Okay? He wants to make sure that Satan hasn't tempted them, that Satan hasn't led them astray, as Timothy goes to strengthen the believers and encourage them. Now, if Paul was kind of saying before, like, I couldn't stand anymore, can you imagine how he feels now? That he's not only wondering how the Thessalonians are doing, but he's wondering, like, and how's Timothy doing? How is Timothy doing? Like, did I make the wrong choice sending Timothy back? What if they recognize Timothy? What if something happens to him? And so I can imagine that Paul is just like, man, I need Timothy to come back. I've got to make sure that he's okay, and I want to make sure that they are doing well. You know, Paul is the spiritual parent to these believers. And because of this, he's hurting because he doesn't know how his kids are doing. He doesn't know how these young believers are doing in a difficult spiritual setting. As a parent, I kind of understand what Paul was feeling. Okay, there are moments as a parent with your kids that you just kind of have this feeling of like, I'm not in control. I can't be there with them in this situation. I don't know how they're doing. Like, it's like if you've ever taken your kid to the first day of kindergarten, okay, and you can't sit in class with them all day long. That's weird. So it's this matter of like, you know, taking my kids to the first day of kindergarten, like, oh, I hope they're okay. I hope they make friends. I hope they don't get bullied. I hope all these things. I want to know, like, I can't wait for them to come home because I want to hear how they did. I want to hear that they had a great day. Or my younger son, Logan, he just got his driver's license. And it's this idea of like, you know, and he's got a landscaping job this summer. And so, you know, he's got his driver's license. And so he's driving away for the very first time. And it's 6:15 in the morning. Like, oh my gosh, I hope he has a good day. Like, I hope everything goes fine. Like, you know, and you can't control the situation. You just have to wait until you hear back from the person to see that they're doing okay. And just like I desperately want to hear from my kids and how they're doing, that's how Paul is feeling, waiting for Timothy to come back to hear how the Thessalonian believers are doing. And he gets the best news possible. Paul gets the best report possible. Timothy comes back and he says, the Thessalonians, they're doing great. Their faith is growing. Like, they remember your time with them, even though it was a few weeks. Like, they fondly remember that time. They desperately want to be with you, Paul, as much as you want to be with them. And it's in this report and then Paul's response that we see why it's essential to strengthen the faith of others. I want to read verses 7 and 8 again for you. Paul writes, therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now, we really live since you are standing firm in the Lord. So even though things in Paul's life were extraordinarily difficult, he's facing persecution in every city that he goes to. People want to arrest him. People want to put him on trial. People want to kill him. And despite all that, his soul is being lifted because he knows the believers way far away in Thessalonica are doing well, that they are growing. When the people that we're investing in our lives in, when their faith is growing, we find that we are the beneficiaries as well. Not only are they growing, but our spirits are being lifted as well because they are doing well. And while Paul is filled with joy because of this report of what's going on in Thessalonica, he's continually committing to them in terms of what he wants to do for them. I'm going to read from verse 10 again really quickly. Paul writes, "Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith." You know, so Paul's excited for them. He's joyful for how they're doing, but he continues, right, "But I'm going to keep praying for you until I can finally get back, because there's so much more that I want to teach you. There's so much more that I want to share with you about God. There's so many more things that I want to provide to help you grow, because you're not there yet. You're not mature in your faith." And that's not a slam or a rebuke of the Thessalonian believers. He's just saying that there's just so much more. It's been such a short time that they've known Jesus, and he can't wait to get back and to pour into them. And that needs to be the attitude that we have when it comes to people that are younger in their faith than we are. You know, if like Paul, you believe that it's essential to strengthen the faith of others, then who can you serve as a spiritual parent just like Paul did for the Thessalonians? Is there somebody whose faith journey that you can invest in as that person is seeking after God? How can you support that person? How can you pour into their life? Like Paul, we need to do whatever it takes to ensure that those who are younger in the faith are standing strong. It's not just about me making sure that I'm spending all sorts of time in the Bible, and I'm going through Bible study after Bible study after Bible study after class after class after class. Like, I need to make sure that I'm so strong. Like, maybe we need to take a step back from my own personal growth. Again, not that I'm going to stop reading the Bible or stop studying the Bible or stop being in the community group, but maybe I need to take a step back and ask myself the question, am I investing in others who are starting to grow in the faith? And it doesn't mean that you have to have all the answers for somebody else. That's actually not what it requires at all. Maybe it's as simple as you just start reading the Bible with somebody who's younger in the faith, and as they have questions, you can begin talking about it. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be your own children, although if you've got kids, those are great people to invest in spiritually. But it could be, some of the kids, maybe in your family, maybe at the church, maybe it's students, just anybody who's younger in their faith and needs to be poured into. You can be a Paul in that person's life. You can do what it takes to help them grow, to make some sacrifices in your own life to see that they begin to grow. Maybe for some of us, maybe you've been in a community group with the same people for years and years and years. And this may be super uncomfortable, but it may be time for some of you to say, it's time for me to lead a new group and focus on some younger believers and take a group of younger folks and help them grow in their own faith, even at the sacrifice of stepping out of your group. That's not easy, but again, this was Paul's focus, and I believe this is what Christ calls every believer to investing in those that are growing in their faith. You know, if you are stagnant in your faith, I'd say it's probably time to spend less time burying your head in the Bible. And again, I'm not saying don't study the Bible, but if you're stagnant in your faith, maybe it's not as much about reading as much as I can right now, but maybe it's really time to start strengthening the faith of somebody else. Because if you invest in somebody else's faith journey, you might be surprised to see how much it impacts your own relationship with Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the example that Paul sets for us in this letter as he's writing to this dear church that he loves so much. God, help us to remember that it's not just about focusing on our own relationship with you, but it's also just as important that we are helping others to grow. God, ultimately, you are the one that causes growth in a person, but you want to use us to be part of that process, God. And it's essential that we strengthen the faith of others, God, because ultimately, God, we grow as well because of that. God, we thank you. We thank you for the challenge in your word, God. Thank you for investing in us so that we can invest in others. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thanks for sharing with us this morning, Pastor Mike. Remember to stay connected and up to date with us by receiving our All Church email, following us on social media, and especially on our website. Stay tuned if you'd like to join us for a communion moment. Otherwise, we'll see you next week as we continue our series, Essential. We're going to move into a time of communion. Communion is something that at Rainier View we do every single week. And it's just a chance for us to take a moment to breathe and remember the goodness of God, to remember who He is, to remember His promises and that His words are true, to remember His sacrifice on the cross and the fact that He did that for the forgiveness of our sins. So take a couple minutes, hopefully you have some juice nearby, piece of bread, and spend some time praying and thanking God for who He is and what He's done in your life.